The story you're about to see, for the most part, is true. And that's what's so scary about it. Well, 1952, Memphis, Tennessee. High school senior and the once and future king of rock and roll, Elvis Aaron Presley, toils part-time as a movie usher and daydreams of a career in show business. He models his hairstyle after his favorite actor, Tony Curtis, and his singing style after his favorite singer, Dean Martin. Elvis was ready. 1952, and Senator Richard Milhouse Nixon, using the new power of television, delivers his infamous Checkers speech in a desperate attempt to remain Eisenhower's running mate.
I should say this, that Pat doesn't have a mink coat, but she does have a respectable Republican cloth coat.
It works.
And I always tell her that
Nixon stays.
She's good in anything.
1956, and overnight, Elvis Presley is the biggest sensation in the country, exploding white America with something new called rock and roll. Starring in his first movie, and seen only from the waist up on The Ed Sullivan Show because of suggestive gyrations which earned him the nickname Elvis the Pelvis. 1956, now Vice President Richard Nixon is again fighting for his political life.
You will find that not 1 cent of $18,000 or anybody else from a constituent went into my personal pocket. It never has and it never will in the future.
Nixon stays on the ticket, poised for the presidency, and soon earns his own nickname, Tricky Dick. 1960, after 2 years in the Army, Sergeant Elvis Presley returns home from Germany and begins his transition from rebellious rocker to a sort of latter-day Bing Crosby, duetting with Frank Sinatra on Witchcraft in Elvis's only television appearance for the next 8 years. 1960, and following the first ever televised presidential debates, Richard Nixon loses the election to John F. Kennedy. While Frank Sinatra hosts JFK's inaugural, Nixon leaves Washington for California, where he will spend the next 8 years. 1962, Elvis is about to become a cultural dinosaur as the Beatles, Vietnam, the civil rights struggle, and psychedelia overtake America. Elvis remains in a time warp. 1962, Richard Nixon, in a surprising defeat, loses his bid to become governor of California and utters his now famous comment to reporters.
You don't have Nixon to kick around anymore.
And becomes irrelevant for most of the 60s. 1968, after years of making movies such as Tickle Me, Harum Scarum, and Clam Bake, Elvis Presley dons a black leather suit and miraculously resurrects himself on his December television special. Elvis is back. 1968, on the campaign trail, Richard Nixon completes his own miraculous resurrection, promising he has a secret plan to win the war in Vietnam, a plan he can't reveal until he's elected. Nixon wins the presidency, and the war continues for another 5 years. Nixon is back. And in 1970, 4 days before Christmas, these two icons of the 50s, adrift in the 60s, who strangely seem to rise and fall and then rise again together, finally meet in the White House for reasons that still seem beyond comprehension. Elvis's trip to the White House begins here, in Memphis, at Elvis's legendary antebellum mansion, Graceland. The evening began as a typical one for Elvis. With his family upstairs, Elvis was downstairs, surrounded by his ever-present paid buddies, the Memphis Mafia. Yet, before the night was over, Elvis would do the unthinkable, leading to the most bizarre weekend in Elvis's entire life.
Okay, what else is on here, man? What else is on, huh?
Hey, looky, it's Robert Goulet.
That'll be enough of that shit.
My boy.
Well, hell, that's enough TV anyway, man.
Well, I'm bored of sitting around. Hey, I know, let's send out some cheeseburgers and shoot some pool, huh?
Are y'all coming or what?
You said tonight about how we could tell our wives we'd be home early to trim the trees and shit.
You mean to tell me not one of you motherfuckers gonna come shoot pool with me? Huh? That's y'all, didn't I, huh?
Elvis was unhappy. He'd failed in his ambition to become a serious movie actor. His Las Vegas appearances after just a year were already boring him. He was isolated, never going anywhere without his bodyguards, and relations were strained with his wife. Not that I ever knew Elvis. I just know this from reading some books.
Everybody gets a new colt this Christmas. Come on, come on. Single action army. Yeah, well, the bullets are extra, man.
The bullets are extra.
The boys behave yourselves. I'll see y'all tomorrow.
Thanks, all right. Thanks,
Hey, Dodger, want that peanut butter and banana sandwich? Brought an extra butter now.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that's it.
You smell those bananas? I told you he'd be in the kitchen.
Elvis, there's something we gotta talk about.
It's important, Elvis.
Oh, man, not again.
Now, I know you hate for me to talk about money, but, well, you charged $38,000 in guns this month.
Oh, they're Christmas presents, Daddy.
Yeah, and this Mercedes place out in Hollywood. You bought 6 Mercedes last week?
Yeah, they were the big presents. God damn it, can't I even be generous at Christmas time, huh?
You really can't keep spending like this, Elvis.
You keep this up, we're gonna end up broke.
That's the most ridiculous thing I ever heard. I make millions of dollars a year.
You don't keep that. First off, Colonel gets his 50%.
Wait, I thought he got 25%.
He used to, see, but he convinced us a few years ago, after all he'd done for us, that he deserved a raise.
Okay, so after that old son of a bitch takes his cut, man, I still got half my money.
Not after Uncle Sam rifles your pockets. We don't take no deductions, son. You got to rein it in. Or you're gonna blow all your money. Maybe we ought to set up some kind of allowance thing.
We have a daughter to think about now, Elvis.
Maybe $500 a week?
It's my money, goddammit! And I'll spend it any goddamn way I want to, goddammit!
You forget who my grandson is. You don't talk like that to a king.
I don't have money around here, goddammit! For when my wings were spread in the sun, their shadow upon the earth was a turtle.
Damn it. Elvis and I were very dear friends, and I can tell you this. When even the philosophy of Khalil Gibran couldn't calm him down, there was still one place left that he could go.
Friday night and I just got paid. Do about my money, don't try to save. Heart says go, go, have a time. Well, it's Saturday night, babe, and I'm feeling fine. I'm gonna rock it up. I'm gonna rip it up. We're gonna shake it up. Have a ball tonight. Well, I got me a date and it won't be late. Picked her up in my 88. Shagged on down by the social hall. When the joint starts jumping, I'll have a ball. Gonna rock it up. We're gonna rip it up. We're gonna shake it up. We're gonna ball it up. I'm gonna rip it up. Have a ball tonight.
Sleep tight, button here. Daddy loves you.
Elvis, have you calmed down? Elvis? Elvis, wait. Oh, what, are you going somewhere?
Ow!
All alone? Where are you going dressed like that? Wait, wait, let's call some of the guys to go with you. This is crazy, Elvis!
Don't worry, he always dresses like that.
Dad, he's just gone out alone.
Oh, yeah, I'm crazy. Crazy like a fox. Hang on, Jesse Garin. We're going for a ride.
Last time Elvis went off anywhere, you know, without the guys to protect him?
I think it was. Let me see. It's 1956.
When he was 21?
The unthinkable had happened. Elvis was out. But there was method in his madness. Elvis had a secret destination, a secret plan. And now, for the first and only time in his adult life, Elvis was planning to step onto a commercial air flight, alone, with no bodyguards, no one to protect him from the real people around him. Yet, before he could face that challenge, he had to overcome another equally daunting hurdle. He had to purchase his own plane ticket, all by himself.
Next.
Well, I guess that's me.
Hello, Mr. Presley.
It's, Karen, right? I'm a little psychic, you know.
You are?
Caught me, huh? Now, Karen, don't say my name out loud, okay? I'm traveling, what's that word, you know, where we don't want to be recognized?
Incognito?
That's me. Incognito.
Okay.
Good. Now, listen, I need to get to Washington, D.C.
Oh, right. And will you be, coming back to Memphis?
Honey, I always come back to Memphis. Right now, I just, don't know when.
Oh, we have a flight that leaves in about 40 minutes, so will that be all right? Mm-hmm. Mr.
John Burroughs.
Right. And how would you like to pay for that, Mr. Burroughs?
Well, can I convince you to take cash? Hell, I don't believe this. I left home with 20 fucking... Excuse me. Well, it's kind of funny, isn't it? See, usually one of my guys takes care of these details.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Listen, can you just send the bill to the colonel?
Well, gee, personally, I'd like to, but if I give you a ticket without you paying for it, I'd catch holy hell. Mr. Davis, could you please step over here? He's my supervisor. Maybe he can...
Yes, Karen, what seems to be the problem? Oh, my goodness! Mr. Burroughs. John Burroughs.
He's incognito.
Well, of course he is. Yeah.
So, the situation here is, was a little embarrassing, really. See, I don't have any money on me.
Well, that's easy. We'll just take one of your checks, Mr. Burroughs.
Well, no, actually, you can't. See, I don't have a checking account. See, usually one of my guys takes care of this. Can you just send the bill to the colonel?
Oh, well, normally we don't do that.
Well, now, how would you like to drive my brand new Cadillac till I get back?
No, that's not necessary. That's a brand new Cadillac. Oh, no. You sure you don't have a credit card, like a Bank of America card or MasterCard or something like that?
Credit card, yeah, wait a minute. I think I keep one in here in case of an emergency, and there's definitely an emergency.
My boy. Don't leave home without it, huh?
That's wonderful. Mr. Burroughs, can I tell you, I loved your song, Kentucky Rain. It brought a tear to my eye every time I heard it.
Well, thank you very much.
Can I get your autograph?
Yeah, I'd be happy to.
To Randy, your biggest fan, Randy.
And if you'll just sign right there, you're all set.
Oh, so that's how this works, huh? You just copy it and I sign it?
Now, you've been teasing me this whole time, haven't you? I had no idea you had such a sense of humor.
Neither did I, baby.
Oh, he couldn't have been nicer.
Or cuter.
I idolized him.
I wish I'd have screwed him. Right behind the counter, purple suit and everything.
I wish I could have watched. Allow me to escort you to the VIP lounge?
Well, I appreciate that, Randy. Hey, you got any food in there? I missed dinner.
Oh, yeah. We got fruit and cheese and crackers and cookies and all you need, shrimp. After that, I'll just take you right onto the plane. We can just bypass security. I mean, you know, we know you're not armed and dangerous, don't we?
And after the spate of recent hijacking, security is up at Memphis International, ensuring safe holiday travels. This is Walt Carpenter at the airport. Cut. They'll never use this shit. Hey, turn around. Get a shot of that. That's Elvis. He's all alone.
So why was Elvis going to Washington? Because he wanted to become a U.S. Deputy Marshal with the DEA. I swear to God.
And this is in spite of the fact that Elvis had been popping pills for years. He'd been introduced to speed when he was in the Army.
Pills wasn't drugs to Elvis. Because he had script. You know, from a doctor. Prescription. Drugs was pot. LSD. All them drugs made popular by the damn Beatles.
Although he didn't talk about it in public, Elvis didn't like the Beatles. He thought they'd come over here and stolen his throne.
So despite being the most successful recording artist in the history of the world, what Elvis really wanted was to be a government agent, like James Bond. Elvis. 00 Elvis.
Already a deputy sheriff in Memphis and in Palm Springs, Elvis, unbeknownst to anyone, had secretly scheduled a meeting for Monday morning with the U.S. Deputy Narcotics Director, hoping to convince him to appoint Elvis an actual United States Deputy Marshal in drug enforcement.
Excuse me. Melissa? Yeah. Would you be sweet enough, honey, to give me a cup of water? I need to, wash down some medicine.
Certainly, Mr.
Burrow.
Okay.
Oh, pardon me, but aren't you one of those, you know, rock and rollers?
No, ma'am. John Burroughs, Deputy Sheriff, Memphis Police. I'm undercover.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were one of those groups, you know, like the Beatles.
Lady, the Beatles couldn't polish my guitar strap.
Thank you.
Ninety minutes later, Elvis arrived in Washington. his face swollen from an allergic reaction to too much chocolate.
Taxi, sir?
Yeah, thanks. Whew, kind of cold here, man, isn't it?
Where to?
What's the name of that, the hotel, the big hotel here in Washington. What's it called?
The Washington Hotel?
We got a wise guy here, huh? Yeah, okay. That's it, man, the Washington Hotel. Take me there, huh? Man, what's that noise coming out of that radio?
It's Motown, a new group, the Jackson 5. Well, my kids love them.
Man, it scares me to think what my daughter's gonna listen to when she grows up.
On the way to the hotel, Elvis made an unexpected stop.
Hey, wait, wait, man.
Wait right here, man, I'll be right back.
Hey, you thinking of going in there?
You want a donut?
Well, it's none of my business, man. But even I don't go in there at this hour.
Let me explain this to you, man. All I had in that damn airplane were these little tiny peppermints, okay? Now just don't drive off.
That honky, old fave faggot motherfucker.
Hey, man, no, man, no. You know who that is? That's Elvis Presley, man.
Elvis Presley.
Can you move, please?
You crazy motherfucker. What the hell he be doing in here?
Buying donuts. That's what he be doing in here.
Can I help you?
Yeah, how you doing, Chief? Give me a couple of them sorry ones. Yeah, those ones, yeah. Oh, and the chocolate with the custard. And maybe one of them ones down there with little sprinkles on top.
That's Elvis fucking Presley.
And three of them glazed ones. But hey, make sure you give me the fresh ones now. I don't want none of that stale shit.
It's you, man. Elvis Presley.
Yeah, you got me confused, son.
No, I know that voice. Hey, listen up. The king is here. Oh, you're Elvis, man. Look at all those diamond rings. Lord have mercy.
Yeah, I am on keeping them, too.
Shit!
How much for the donuts, man?
That's all right, man. On the house.
You sure? I got a 20.
My treat. Merry Christmas.
Well, thank you very much. Nobody follow me outside now, and no one will get hurt. I always wanted to say that.
Hey, you know, sometimes a man just needs a good donut. Anyway, Elvis, now full of confidence and custard, decides to go sightseeing. Elvis's weekend is just beginning.
Hey, slow down a minute, man. Slow down right here. Wow. Man, it's a beautiful sight, isn't it? Boy, it just makes you feel all patriotic just to see it, don't it?
You gotta remember, it's called the White House.
Oh, no, let's not make this about color. It's Christmas time, for Christ's sakes. Peace on Earth. Well, your family celebrates Christmas, right? Just like mine. Yeah. Oh, now look there, see? People of all color caroling the White House.
They ain't singing Deck the Halls, my man. They protesting the war.
Yeah.
Now, that don't ruin everything. Damn drug-taking hippies. Let's get out of here, man.
And on a final note, look who we caught a glimpse of tonight at the airport. And here's what makes Elvis so great. All his fame and fortune, he still travels by himself. He may be the king, but he's still just a good old Memphis boy. God bless you, Elvis.
Amen.
At the airport?
You think he was buying a plane ticket? We can't afford that.
Dad. Oh, my God. What's he doing? Elvis can't travel alone. He doesn't carry money. He doesn't even know his own phone number.
He don't know his own phone number?
Hello, Farley. Did you just see the news?
I'll find him. Don't you worry.
I want to make sure he's okay. Elvis all alone. He's like a little kid out there.
I'll track him down. I mean, Elvis Presley in a purple cape suit. How tough could that be to find?
How can a man not know his own phone number?
Elvis had checked into the Washington Hotel, still using his alias, John Burroughs. He ordered his favorite meal, and, comfortably hidden, he planned to hole up there until his meeting on Monday morning.
What's the $1 million look like, John? Yeah, okay, man. John Wayne.
No matter what else happens, no matter who gets killed, I'm gonna blow your head off.
Remember, you may have all the wealth in the world. You may have family. You may have friends. But when day is done and the lights go out, you are all alone with just yourself.
Oh, man. I just realized this again. I never spent a night alone in my whole life. I just checked in here, John Burroughs. Remember me?
Yes, Mr. Burroughs.
Listen, I'm going out for a little while, so just hold on to my room for me, okay?
Yes, sir.
Oh, you want to see my credit card again?
No, sir. When you checked in was sufficient.
Okay. Well, by the way, somehow my TV blew up, so I'd appreciate you putting in a new one. Taxi!
May I help you?
Too late, honey. I'm married. Kidding you. Yeah, I want to take the red eye to L.A.
No, look, I'm sorry, operator. I don't know any John Burroughs.
Bobby, it's me, man.
E, that's you?
Okay, operator, I'll accept the call.
Go ahead.
E, what's with all the mystery, man?
I'm in Washington, and I'm coming to L.A. I need you to pick me up, man. I walked out of Graceland.
What are you telling me, Elvis? You ran away from home?
Yeah, I did. My boy.
Hey, your wife called. All worried. Want to know if I'd heard from you.
You didn't tell her anything, did you?
You hadn't called me yet, Elvis.
Well, I'm not calling you now, either. This is top secret.
Okay, now listen. It's Pan Am flight number 85, man. Number 85, arriving around 1:30.
Hey, call Sir Harold, will you? Oh, and can you call me a doctor, man? I think my face is all swole up.
You eating chocolate again, Elvis?
I gotta go, man.
Bobby, thanks. I'll see you in a few hours, huh?
My boy. Woo!
Excuse me. Thank you. Sorry.
Hey. Wait, sir.
Sorry, Chief. Just my gun. There's nothing to worry about.
Your guns!
Whew, it's cold out there, honey.
Well, hi. Oh, Mr. Presley, hello.
Well, hi, Mindy and Pamela. Listen, ladies, I'm traveling under the name of John Burroughs. You understand?
Oh, sure.
Oh, of course. Yes.
Thank you. So where am I?
You would be right here in 2B.
Oh. Or not 2B, huh? Listen, could I possibly get a cup of water? I need to take some medicine.
Oh, I'll get it.
Oh, okay.
Sir. You cannot fly in this aircraft carrying weapons.
Well, don't worry, Duke. I'm not going to hijack the plane to Cuba.
That is not funny.
Okay, man, look. Don't you know who I am?
He's John Burroughs.
Well, no, actually, I'm Elvis Presley.
Oh, yeah? Well, you must think I'm really stupid, Mr. Burroughs. Are you going to hand over your weapons?
Nobody takes my guns.
Now, you don't understand. You cannot fly carrying weapons.
No, man, you don't understand. I'm not giving up my guns.
Bill, you better come see this.
Well, this isn't Palm Springs, Mr. Burroughs. You're outside your jurisdiction. Now, this is your last chance. Hand over those guns or else.
Or else what?
Or else I must insist you leave this aircraft.
Fine. Then I won't fly in your damn airplane.
Are you crazy? You just threw off Elvis Presley.
Damn it! What do I look like, some kind of goddamn Cuban revolutionary?
Mr. Presley, wait! Please wait, sir! Please!
There's been a terrible mistake here, Mr. Presley. Please, come back on the plane.
I don't travel without my guns.
No, absolutely. I mean, that guy is an idiot, huh? Now, I'm the captain of this plane, and I make the calls. And it would be an honor, sir, if you and your guns flew on my aircraft.
No more hassles?
I swear, Mr. Presley, I swear. I idolized you for years. When I was a kid, I saw Love Me Tender 14 times. I cried every time you died.
Oh, now, that's all right, son. Elvis is still here.
When I'm flying high, and I feel that I could cry, I look up to my friend in the sky.
This all happened. The airplane, the donut shop. You can't make this up.
You can't make this up.
You're not going to believe this. He's flown to Washington.
Washington? D.C.?
I don't know what he's up to, but I don't like it. Now, there's one last flight out of here tonight. I'm thinking I ought to take it.
Oh, Farley, if you wouldn't mind. I mean, I know it's a lot of trouble, but...
No, it's no trouble. I love the guy. And hell... Elvis Presley wandering around Washington in a purple cape suit? How tough could that be to find?
Elvis, up in the air, was looser on this, his second plane ride of the evening.
Well, the origin of karate is just fascinating. Now, the word karate means, well, kara means open, tae means hand. Pew. Open hand, see?
Mm-hmm.
That's an art. It's not a sport. It involves yoga and meditation. It's from the Buddhist monks. See, they used to study different animals to learn self-defense. Now, my karate name is Tiger. Well, that's why I recorded a song called Tiger Man.
I never heard it.
Is your first time flying alone?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, me too. You okay?
I miss my mom.
Yeah, me too. You want to get some more ice cream? Come on.
Oh, God, tell me he's on this plane.
I'm confused. I thought you quit the Memphis Mafia.
Well, it's kind of like the CIA. They never actually let you quit.
I believe I see him. There. There he was, in this outrageous purple costume, his face visibly swollen, a stewardess perched on each arm, and a doctor waiting at his house to administer an allergy shot for his facial swelling. Quintessential Elvis.
Mindy, Pamela, this is I.
Bobby and Sir Harold.
I promise the ladies we give them a ride home.
The king has come to L.A.
Oh, Mr. Burroughs.
I'm serious, man. So then he says, Lord almighty, look at all them diamond rings. I look him right in the eye, pull out my coat and say, yeah.
And I am on keeping them, too. Oh, man, you should have seen his face.
You gone crazy.
I'm crazy, man. I've been crazy. I'm going crazy or something.
You okay?
Yeah. No. I don't know. You wanna know the truth, man? I don't know what I'm doing right now.
Well, what's wrong, E?
I'm just bored of tears, man. Nothing's turned out like I thought it would when I was a kid.
Really?
I used to watch all those movies, you know, and I thought that's what life was like when you grew up. But a hero wins, girl kisses you. Yeah. Yeah, nobody tells you what it's like to be married, man. We're famous. You pay the price of fame with your nerves, I'll tell you, boy. I swear, man, I'm thinking of quitting the whole damn business.
No, E, come on. What would you do?
I don't know. So I just always felt that God chose me to do something important, you know, like he, I don't know, like he singled me out for some higher purpose. I mean, why else would he keep me alive and let my twin brother, Jesse Guerin, be stillborn? I just wish I could find out what it is I'm supposed to do in this lifetime.
Will you ever consider you might have already done it?
What's that, man? Come to King of Rock and Roll? Boy, you gotta be kidding me.
You know, sometimes I wonder what people would say, you know, if they knew that, I didn't even like rock and roll music anymore. Well, they wouldn't believe it.
Yeah, probably not.
My boy, my boy.
You enjoying yourself at all, Elvis?
Yeah, I'm singing. Hey, one night in Las Vegas, Dean Martin showed up, you know, and I sang Everybody Loves Somebody for him. Man, it was a fun night. I don't know, maybe I should just join the gospel quartet, you know, like I wanted to when I was a kid. I tell you, my mama would have liked that. That's the only music we're singing, man. Why don't you swing down, sweet chariot, stop and let me ride. Swing down, sweet chariot, stop and let me ride. Rock me, Lord, come and easy. I got friends on the other side. Of course, then I'd still be driving a truck. Man, I'm tired of being me.
At the White House, Richard Nixon was uneasy.
Hell no, we won't go! Hell no, we won't go! Surprised to see you here on a Sunday, Mr. Haldeman.
Surprised to be here myself, Hadley.
Mr. President, I got here as soon as I could. What's the problem?
They hate me.
Who hates you?
Look at them out there. The Sunday before Christmas. You'd think they'd have shopping to do. Don't protesters have loved ones?
They don't hate you, sir. They hate the war.
I didn't start the war. The Kennedys started it. Why don't they hate them?
Well, maybe it's something to do with the way they were assassinated.
I didn't ask to be in Vietnam, goddammit. But I refuse to be the first president of the United States to suffer a defeat. Now, how would that look in the future? As I've always said, I want peace, but I want peace with honor.
That reminds me, we have to get back to Teddy Kennedy. He called about the POWs.
Fuck him.
Sure.
Let Kissinger call him back. He's on top of it anyway. When he's not out wooing some Hollywood starlet. Where does that man find time to sleep? That's what I want to know. You know, if I'd been elected instead of Kennedy, we wouldn't be in this Vietnam mess in the first place. I beat Jack Kennedy in 1960, you know. It was the mafia who stole the election.
So you've said, sir.
Kennedy couldn't keep his dick in his pants. He and Sam Giancana were screwing the same showgirl. Hoover played me the tapes over dinner. Hoover's a sick man. Sit down, Bob, relax. Speaking of the mafia, I'm reading a new book, The Godfather, Mario Puzo. It's about a mob family and a singer who sounds like Frank Sinatra. No, I don't mean sounds like in the way he actually sounds when he sings.
I understand.
It'll make a hell of a movie. And I can only see one actor who could play The Godfather, Chuck Heston. But these mafia guys have one thing right. The one thing a man wants more than anything in this world is to be treated with respect. That's the key. Disagree with me, yes, but disagree with respect.
That's true.
Would you like some cottage cheese with ketchup?
No, thank you, sir.
Disrespect a mafia don, and you become his enemy. And bang, bang, you get whacked. Now, wouldn't you suppose that the president of the United States deserves at least as much respect as a mafioso? And if not, shouldn't we take action?
You're not suggesting that we, whack our enemies.
Not with a gun, no. But, hear me out on this. If we made up a list of all our enemies, you know, the bastards in the pinko liberal Jew-dominated press like that prick Dan Rather and that cocksucker...
Daniel Shore.
Or the big celebrity liberals like Paul Newman or, what's his name, Hanoi Jane Fonda.
An enemies list.
An enemies list. And we take that list and we slip it under the table to, say, Internal Revenue. They do a spot check, perfectly legal. And if they find anything, bang, bang!
Nixon, at this point, was in a high state of paranoia. Of course, I never knew him to be in a low state of paranoia.
He was uncomfortable. The way he spoke, the way he viewed the world, even the way he used curse words to try to show he was a regular guy. Uncomfortable. Possibly unbalanced.
It could work.
I knew you'd like it. Hit him where it hurts.
In the pocketbook.
In the pocketbook. I learned that lesson when I was 6 years old, back in Yorba Linda. I came home one day with a handful of grapes I'd picked from a neighbor's grapevine. My mother, bless her soul, made me take out every penny I'd saved up in my piggy bank and pay that lady for those grapes. That hurt. Now, this list is just between us. Maybe we'll tell Ehrlichman. This is what really hurts. The children of America hate me. I tried reaching out to them. I went on Laugh-In and said, "Sock it to me," remember? What is that song they keep singing?
I believe that's Chicago by Crosby, Nash, Stills, and Young.
Bing Crosby joined a group? No, must be one of his kids. All talentless, except one. I saw him in the Twilight Zone. Yes, I bombed Cambodia. A gutsy call. Well, was it my fault that those assholes in the National Guard shot those students at Kent State? I need to find a way to reach those kids, to change my image, to let them know it's okay to like me. I need ideas, Bob.
I'll work on it.
Good, good. Do that. By the way, do you think the Chargers stand a chance against the Raiders today?
No, not a chance.
Shit.
You have to realize, we were so square then. So square. I mean, they had us out for months trying to get All in the Family off the air because it was so outrageous. Bad for America. We were all nuts.
Bing Crosby?
The Earl of Oxford, writing under the pen name William Shakespeare, described Elvis best. Uneasy lies the head that wears a crown.
Well, it's great you're coming out here, man. Starting your own career. I'm really proud of you. I mean it.
Well, thanks, E. It means a lot to me, you know, it does. How long are you out here for?
Well, I'm flying back to Washington tonight. I got a meeting in the morning.
What's going on, Elvis?
Can't tell you yet.
My boy, my boy.
Well, I tell you, it's too beautiful a day to sit around in here. Why don't we go down to Sunset Strip, walk around, see what's happening?
Man, are you crazy? I can't do that. I'd be mobbed.
Were you mobbed on the plane?
Well, no, but that's different. Such a controlled environment. You know, half the people are asleep or scared.
Okay, well, make a deal with me. We go down to Sunset for 1 hour. If anybody hassles you,
man, I'll be recognized in 1 minute.
Things are different out there, E. Everyone's hipper. They're doing their own thing. You don't have to rent a roller rink or a movie theater anymore to get out of the house.
Man, you've got to be crazy.
Last night you told me you're tired of the way your life is. You want to change things? I mean, you came out here all alone. You never done that before. Well, give it a try.
It's Sunday, man. Raiders are playing the Chargers.
Okay. All right, well, listen, I promised this chick today I'd, So if you don't mind, I'll be back later. I'll take you out to the airport, right?
And don't do anything I wouldn't do, man. And if you do, take some Polaroids, huh?
Woo! All right, big play coming up. San Diego has the ball. Raider defense breaks the huddle. Chargers approach the line. Third down and 12. There's a snap. Aiden drops back into the pocket. Lots of pressure on him. He's got to roll out.
Go to him. Go to him.
Yeah. And he throws it down the sideline.
Yes! Oh, shit!
Back now. Come on, come on. Block for him now, son. Come on. Let's do it. Let's do it. Let's do it. Run him back, baby. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. These are all hippies down here, Jesse Guerin. Man, look at these freaks. Okay, I say we're recognized in 2 minutes.
All right, man.
Who
How are you, baby? Hey, what do you say, dude?
Peace, bro.
Hey, mama. Hey, man, how you doing?
Groovy, Sis.
Give me five, brother.
Are you sure it was Elvis?
Yeah, it was him, all right. He checked in as John Burris, and are you ready for this? He's flown to L.A.
L.A.? What is he doing?
I don't know. But I know I'll find him at the house. You know Elvis. He never leaves the house when he's in L.A.
You making a list and checking it twice, man?
Thank you. Merry Christmas.
Man, this is why I can walk around and be with people. A record store. Man, it's been 15 years. What the hell is this? Excuse me, Duke. This is a record store, or what is this place, man?
Man, what are you smoking?
Oh, my God. You're the king!
Hey, now, whoa, whoa, whoa. There's only one king. That's Jesus Christ. Now, I'm just a singer.
Elvis Presley, I don't believe this. I mean, this is out of sight, man.
Whoa, this is trippy, but yeah, this is a record store.
Hey, what's that smell, man? Is that pot?
Pot? No, that's incense.
Incense? What's that, supposed to make the record smell better? Man, this place is spooky.
Well, hey, is there anything I can help you with?
Huh. Woodstock. Half a billion naked people rolling in mud high on drugs. Someone explain that to me.
Yeah, you know, peace, love, quarter million naked chicks. So, Elvis, how come you're wearing a cross and a star, David?
Well, I don't want to miss out on heaven on account of a technicality. Hey, what's this? Those damn ugly phonies, the Rolling Stones, got their own newspaper now? Well, I should have my own magazine, goddammit.
No, Elvis, man. That's just the new underground music paper. What, you ain't never heard of the Rolling Stone? You ain't never heard of the Rolling Stone, have you?
Yeah, sure, man. I heard of it. You know, I just don't read it. You know Lennon?
Mm-hmm.
He the one with the wife, the photographers come and see him when they was in bed?
Yeah, they had the bed in for peace.
That is seriously fucked up, man.
Hey, all they're saying, let's give peace a chance.
What the hell is all this?
Well, that's rolling papers, you know, for grass. Weed, dope, ganja, Mary Jane, cess, reefer, smoke, hemp, you know, good life.
In a record store?
Hell yeah!
Man, this is crazy.
Man, I can't believe the Beatles won't get back together.
It's not gonna happen, ma'am. John says it right here. The dream is over.
Excuse me. What kind of pipe is this?
That's a magic pipe.
Got a comedian here. And what's that you're smoking, man? Pot? Oh, hey, honey. Don't you know drugs like that'll kill your brain cells?
Who are you supposed to be? Batman?
That's your brain, baby. That is it, man. I don't see the new Elvis album here. That's the way it is?
Oh, it's the way it is.
I'm playing Abbott and Costello with a pothead here, man. No, that's the name of the album. That's the way it is.
Hey, if it's here, man, Elvis is in the back, you know? In the oldies section.
The oldies section?
Yeah, man, in the back, you know, with Pat Boone and Bobby Rydell. Amphibian.
Well, they're not putting out new records.
Hey, man, maybe you don't realize who you're talking to.
Hey, man, I don't know anyone who buys Elvis albums, all right? Do you? Well, maybe some rednecks.
Let me tell you something, motherfucker.
Hey, Elvis! No! Don't waste them!
You're Elvis Presley? I didn't think you were so old.
Hey, Elvis! It was nice meeting you, man!
Goddamn old section.
Man, it's like being in a Twilight Zone.
Elvis was so isolated. He didn't know what was going on out on the streets or the rest of the world, even. It was like he was Rip Van Elvis.
It's an illegal, immoral war, right?
Right!
We need to shut down this war machine.
Yeah.
Chicky Dicky, that commie-hating fascist pig, is lying to you. He's lying to me. He's lying to all of us.
Yeah.
We're not over there fighting for democracy like John Wayne. This war is about economics, right?
Right!
Why don't you jerks get a job?
I've got a job, sir. I'm doing this to save America.
No, I fought World War II to save America.
The Japanese attacked us. What did the Vietnamese do to us? Big rally tomorrow night, UCLA. We need a huge turnout. Oh, my God. Elvis? Elvis Presley? Oh, man, it is you. Hi, I'm Larry Hopper.
Hey, man.
Wow, man, this is so unbelievable. What? I can't believe you're here, man.
Neither can I, man. Believe me.
You scare me. Women beaters always scare me.
Excuse me?
Well, you said that in Jailhouse Rock. That was my favorite movie. I could quote the whole thing. When I was a kid, I wanted to be you.
What happened, man? You know, all you protesters have forgotten that America's the greatest country on Earth. We're over there fighting communists, man. If we can't support our own army, then... Never mind. What you believe is your business. Excuse me. Can I get a Coke over here, please?
Elvis,
oh,
Elvis, man, you started all this. You're the reason I'm doing this. You are the reason that everybody's doing this, man, even if they don't know it.
Man, you're really crazy.
Can I sit down? You changed the world all by yourself. You shook up the establishment. You freaked out the whole middle-class, white-power-based society. You changed life forever, man. John Lennon himself just said it in his interview in Rolling Stone. He said, before Elvis, there was nothing.
He said that?
Yeah, and I remember that. I remember what it was like before you showed up, man. It was a fucking desert. You shook your ass on TV and nothing has been the same since. Elvis, you were the first revolutionary. And because of what you did a long time ago, we really are changing the world. We're a real social revolution. You belong with us, not with them. If you came out and joined us against the war, man, that would be so fucking powerful. Will you? Just come to UCLA tomorrow night. Just say hello, man.
Well, I'm not there, man. Just start without me, huh?
All right. Well, I guess you could say Elvis told me to go fuck myself, but... Hey, you're not using my real name in this, are you?
It's Farley. I'm at the house. Look, you're not going to believe this. He's made a reservation to fly back to...
Hold it! Drop the phone! Down on the ground!
Ah! 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 Ah!
Ah!
I think Farley just died.
Soon after, across town, Elvis was on his way back to the airport for his third flight in less than 24 hours.
Ladies and gentlemen, Robert Goulet.
Why don't I just turn it off? Listen, I'm sorry, man. I shouldn't have put the idea in your head to go down there.
That guy was wrong, man. You know, my first night at Sun Records with Scotty and Bill, I was just gonna sing ballads, man. Really, that's all I wanted to be, was a ballad singer. You know, like Dean Martin. So we tried a few songs. Harbor Lights and a little song by Johnny Payne. And I couldn't get it right. And everyone was getting real frustrated, you know, so we were just gonna quit. So then I just started goofing around. You know, I started playing That's All Right Mama. You know, the rhythm and blues, yeah. Big Boy Crudder. Just for fun now. Okay, not to record. And Scotty and Bill jump in, man, and we're playing, you know. And Sam Phillips comes out, and he says, "That's it. That's the sound, boy." And that was my first hit. I mean, do you understand what I'm telling you here, man? It was an accident. I had a whole rock and roll thing. My entire career was an accident. I didn't want to change the world. I just wanted to make some money. I'd be in show business. I'd make some movies. So I even dyed my hair black with Tony Curtis. But I was never no revolutionary, man. No way. It wasn't me.
Elvis was so insulated that he never realized his own impact. But fortunately, others saw it.
Yes, it's true. Elvis copied me. My hairstyle, my looks, my smile, my joy, my charm, my Bronx rebelliousness, huh? And he passed it on to four guys in Liverpool, and they were called the Beatles, right? So you can surmise that if it wasn't for Tony Curtis.
Now, E, I cashed a check. It's $500. Be some traveling money for you.
For us.
Excuse me?
You're coming with me. You better hurry up, get your ticket, man. The plane leaves in 15 minutes.
Oh, no, I can't. I just started this new job at the studio. You know, I can't go AWOL already.
No, charter your plane and take you back.
That still won't get me back in time. E, I don't even know why you're going there.
Okay, man, fine. Don't worry about it. I'll go alone.
Enjoy your flight.
Oh, excuse me. Mitzi? Hey, could we get a couple of Cokes here, please?
Why, certainly, Dr. Carpenter.
When'd you become a doctor?
Dr. John Carpenter. Yeah, that was the name of my character in Change of Habit. You know, with Mary Tyler Moore?
Oh, yeah, right. She played the nun that fell in love with
mm-hmm,
you, right?
Mm-hmm.
Excuse me, Dr. Carpenter. You have some fans in the cockpit. They asked me to give you this box of chocolates.
Oh, well, tell them, thank you very much.
I'll be right back with your Cokes, Doctor.
You're not gonna eat all those, are you? Your face is gonna swell up again.
Don't worry, man. I'll just have one or two here. Yeah, how you doing, man?
Hi. Oh. Hey. Are you?
Yeah, I am. That was Presley.
Roy Potter, hi.
All right.
You know, you look different than you did in the movies. Would you like to go in front of me?
No, come on, man. You were here first. I'll just be like everybody else. Oh, you going home for Christmas?
Yes, sir. Richmond.
Well, that's good.
Yeah, it's important being with family. I was in the service too, you know. Yeah, almost 2 years in Germany. That was some wild times, man. But I didn't ask for any special treatment. I served like everybody else. So where you been stationed?
Vietnam? Yes, sir.
Hey, listen, you don't have to keep calling me sir, all right? I'm just a civilian. So you okay?
Well, not really, sir, no.
We won't talk about it, or?
I can. There aren't words to... Unless you were there. It was just hell on earth. Just... I don't know why I'm not dead. I enlisted with three buddies. I'm the only one coming back. I don't even know what we're doing over there.
Could you, would you wait right here a second? I'll be right back.
Bobby, what is it?
Where's that money, man?
Why, you can't spend it up here.
I know. I want to give it to a soldier.
All 500? Yeah, that's all the spending money
Bobby,
we got.
He's just back from Vietnam. Well, there you are. I want you to have this.
No, sir, I can't accept it.
Yes, you can. Hey, listen to me. I'm proud of the job you're doing over there, all right? And I want you and your family to have an extra, extra Merry Christmas. On me.
Thank you, Mr. Presley. God bless you.
Brave boys like him over there fighting, you know, and these spoiled hippies here protesting against him. Well, I see now. I see what this whole trip was about for me.
What?
You know, there are no coincidences in this universe, man. Everything happens for a reason. Well, that's why I've been feeling so lost. Why I stormed out of Graceland. Yeah, so I could come out here among the people and see how fucked up our country is. And I know what I have to do to try to fix it. Excuse me, Mitzi.
Yes. Doctor.
Can I get a pen and some paper, honey? I need to write a letter.
Of course.
You know, I've never known you to write a letter in your whole life. Who are you writing to?
President Nixon. America's in trouble, man. I'm gonna ask to see him today and offer my services as a special agent to counteract the revolution in the streets.
I was stunned. I didn't, what do you say to that?
There you are, Doctor.
Thank you very much.
Elvis, you know, I just want to warn you, he might be busy.
With what?
With, say, maybe a meeting with the President of France.
Well, how long could that take? I know what I'm doing. I'm gonna write him a letter that'll knock his socks off. He'll see me.
Now, Elvis's letter to Nixon. In his own kind of hard to read handwriting, so naive in its simplicity, it's a classic. It's a masterpiece. It starts out, Dear Mr. President.
Dear Mr. President, first, I would like to introduce myself. I am Elvis Presley and admire you and have great respect for your office. I want to express my concern for our country. The drug culture, the hippie demonstrations, the SDS, Black Panthers, etc., do not consider me as their enemy, or as they call it, the establishment. I call it America, and I love it. Sir, I can and will be of any service that I can to help the country out. I have no concern or motives other than helping the country out. So I wish not to be given a title or an appointed position. I can and will do more good, if I were made a federal agent at large. I will help out by doing it my way, through my connections with people of all ages. Sir, I'm staying at the Washington Hotel, room 505. I'm registered under the name of John Burroughs. I will be here for as long as it takes to get the credentials of a federal agent.
E, you can't expect to just drive up to the White House and get a letter to the president.
Man, you got no imagination.
You can get anything you want in this world. You just have to know how to get it. Watch and learn, son. Sir, excuse me, sir.
Do you have official business here?
Well, no, not exactly, but,
Then you'll have to drive on.
Sir, I'm Elvis Presley, and,
Right. You're Elvis Presley, and I'm Willie Mays. Drive on.
Well, then you're a heck of a center fielder, sir. Now, I realize this is a little irregular, but I have a personal letter here for President Nixon, and I'd count it as a personal favor if you'd help me give it to him.
Well, sure, Mr. Presley. Sorry, I didn't recognize you in the cape.
I have done an in-depth study of drug abuse and communist brainwashing techniques, and I am right in the middle of the whole thing where I can and will do the most good. I'm glad to help, just so long as it is kept very private. You can have your staff or whomever call me anytime today, tonight, or tomorrow. I was nominated this coming year one of America's 10 most outstanding young men. That will be in January 18th in my hometown of Memphis, Tennessee. I'd love to meet you, just to say hello if you're not too busy. Respectfully, Elvis Presley.
P.S. I believe that you, sir, were one of the top 10 outstanding men of America also. You really expect me to believe that Elvis Presley wrote this?
It was him, sir. Of course, at first, I didn't recognize him all dressed up in purple.
Bob, Bud and I agree. It'll take very little of the president's time. And it can be extremely beneficial for the president to build some rapport with Presley. In addition, if the president wants to meet with some bright young people outside of the government, Presley might be a perfect one to start with.
You're kidding me, right?
Okay, man. You go back to the hotel and wait for the White House to call, all right?
You know, E, I wouldn't get my hopes up on hearing from the leader of the free world this morning.
You ever know me not to get something once I put my mind to it? You just stay by the phones, okay? Here's the number I'll be at if the White House calls when I'm gone.
Tom Fitzgerald of the DEA? This is the Justice Building?
Mm-hmm. Next time you see me, I'll be Elvis Presley, United States Marshal. I'm John Burroughs. I'm here to see Mr. Fitzgerald. Any more Danish?
Mr. Burroughs?
Elvis Presley, sir. That's just a name I use sometimes for security.
Oh, well, come in, Mr. Presley.
Mm-hmm.
Tom Fitzgerald. Thank you, ladies. Well, this is certainly a surprise. Please have a seat.
Well, thank you very much.
Well, I'm bewildered. How can I help you?
Well, sir, I'm very interested in joining the war on drugs.
Well, that's very encouraging. I'll just put you in touch with our public relations department.
Well, actually, sir, I was looking for something a little more hands-on than that. You see, for example, last month in Las Vegas, I talked to a fellow entertainer who'll have to remain nameless into going off heroin. Now, I'm convinced that in my position, I can do a lot more good work if I had the proper credentials.
What is it that you're looking for?
I want to be appointed a United States Federal Marshal for Drug Enforcement, sir.
well, I'm just not empowered to do that. However, I would be more than happy to arrange an honorary badge for you.
Well, honorary's not gonna impress anybody, sir. See, I'm already a law enforcement official. So I'm a deputy sheriff in Palm Springs and also in my hometown of Memphis. Now, it'd help me if I had the power of the United States government behind me.
I'm sorry, it's just not possible. There are regulations.
Did I mention that I'd also like to contribute $5,000 to your department?
All right now. You call Sam Irvin. Tell the old bastard that he forces the vote on the,
SST funding.
Or, I'll order a...
A special session of Congress?
And screw up their holidays. That always works.
Got it.
Did you read where Bob Mayhew lost his court battle to keep his job with Hughes?
I've already called Mayhew.
Now, if it comes out that Howard Hughes loaned us that,
200 grand.
Well, the shit'll hit the fan.
I've invited Mayhew here for lunch.
Good, good. We need, containment. Anything else?
Yeah. Except you won't believe this. Elvis Presley dropped this letter off to you. He would like to meet with you and be made a federal agent at large.
Do we have such a thing?
No. Now, Dwight and Bud recommended that you meet with him, but I think...
You did it, Bob.
Sir?
This is just what I've been looking for. Elvis Presley. A rock and roll hero to millions wants to help with our anti-drug crusade. Well, this will go a lot farther with the kids than the Art Linkletter. Not to denigrate his help, but this is just what I need to help me change my image with the kids. Something unexpected, like the Duke did.
The Duke of Windsor?
John Wayne. Now, take True Grit. Everything about the Duke is very macho, right? Hemingway-esque. So what did he do? Well, he took off his girdle. He changed his toupee. He put on an eye patch. And presto, he wins an Oscar. That is what I need to do.
Win an Oscar?
No, no. Surprise people. And let the kids know it's groovy to like me.
Okay, maybe. If you were meeting with Bob Dylan or John Lennon, but Elvis plays Vegas.
Now, this like... is no time for your negative.
Sammy...
You just make sure Ollie has plenty Elvis. Of film in the camera.
Junior. Yes, sir.
Elvis. Elvis.
Yes, well, an anti-drug song would be very helpful, but I still can't, if you'd like that honorary badge... Excuse me.
Yeah.
It's for you.
Oh, thank you. Hello. Yeah, hey, Bobby. No, man, I can't do any good here. Well, when they call? What time? I'm leaving right now, man. Well, thank you very much for your time, sir. The White House just called. President Nixon needs to see me.
Oh.
When those of us on the White House staff over 40 heard Richard Nixon was actually going to meet with Elvis Presley, we thought he'd lost his marbles. I mean, we had visions of bumps and grinds in the Oval Office.
So you're going to eat crow now or later, man?
You do amaze me, Elvis.
My boy.
Elvis, wait!
Well, look who's here, huh?
Thank God.
Hey, man, you been following me?
Man, you don't know the half of it. I spent 3 hours in an L.A. jail, Lee.
I can't wait to hear this. Get in, son.
No, wait, please, please. Just tell me we are not going back to the airport.
Yeah, we are.
Oh,
but we're making a couple of stops first.
Okay? Help. Hey. What was he buying this gun for? You're shitting me.
At the White House, Elvis and his bodyguards were greeted by the Secret Service.
you understand you can't take your gift into the Oval Office. No guns in the Oval Office. It's security regulations. But we'll be happy to accept the gun on behalf of the president.
Sure, I understand. Well, I hope you'll like it. It's a real special gun. You know, it killed a lot of Nazis. Oh, and I set it in the case there with 7 silver bullets. You know, at the Lone Ranger.
We'll be sure to tell him. Mr. Presley, you don't have any other guns on you, do you?
Well, you fellas gotta come to Las Vegas next time I'm playing there. Yeah, I get your ringside seats, big suite. Maybe meet some girls, huh?
Thank you very much.
Yeah, my pleasure, man. Sorry, fellas, I forgot about my derringer. How you doing, honey?
Good afternoon.
Hello, Mr. Presley. Hello. Hello. Dwight Chapin.
Oh, nice to meet you, man.
Oh, certainly a pleasure. You gentlemen will have to wait out here. Only Mr. Presley's been cleared to meet the president.
Well, don't worry, fellas. I'll see what I can do, huh?
Mr. President, Mr. Presley is here.
Send him in.
And so Elvis, without sleep, and for the first time all weekend without his guns, goes in to meet the President of the United States. If what you're about to see didn't happen exactly this way, it should have.
Come in, Mr. Presley. May I call you Elvis? Elvis? Come on in.
Mr. President, this is a real honor, sir, to meet you. I mean, but you don't know what this means to me, you know. A poor boy from Tennessee, here in the Oval Office.
It's not exactly oval. It's more roundish.
Oh.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you, sir.
You know, Elvis, seeing you reminds me of the good old 50s, when Americans were proud to be Americans. They weren't outside the White House protesting against the war I didn't start.
Well, that's one of the reasons I'm here, sir. See, I'm anti the anti-war thing. I'm with you 100%. I'd like to show you my badges.
Your badges?
Yes, sir. See, I'm a deputy sheriff in Palm Springs and also Memphis, too.
Are these real or is this a Hollywood?
No, they're real, all right. Yeah. And it's my beautiful wife. And oh, that's my pride and joy right there. It's my little daughter, Lisa Marie.
Oh, she's a beauty.
Yeah, I think so, too.
You know, I have 2 daughters myself, Tricia and Julie. I gotta warn you, they grow up quick. Before you know it, they're bringing home some stranger saying, Daddy, this is who I want to marry. You just hope the guy's not a sicko. Have a seat.
Oh, thank you very much.
I enjoyed your letter, though a few of the words were hard to read. But I'm glad to see you love your country and you want to help out on this drug thing.
No, I want to do whatever I can to help America, sir. I'm no Jane Fonda.
You mean Hanoi Jane?
Yeah.
I believe in free speech, but up to a point. Now, her father portrayed great Americans like young Abe Lincoln and Wyatt Earp and Mr. Roberts and so forth. And this is how she pays him back.
Well, it's all the fault of the Beatles, Mr. President. Art Linkletter was right, man. They ruined America. Well, they come over here, you know, and they made a lot of money, and they got everybody taking drugs.
It was the Beatles?
Yes, sir. Well, they had all the long hair and the funny accents, and people fell for that.
Well, you know, the Kennedys fooled the people the same way. Mm. The hair, the accents, and the rest. I kept telling Jack Kennedy, it's pronounced Cuba, not Cuber. But maybe you're right. Maybe I should add the Beatles to my enemies list.
You an enemies list, sir?
No, of course not. I mean, I might consider such a list, but that would be wrong. You know, Elvis, back in the 50s, I was so busy bolstering up Eisenhower and debating Khrushchev, I didn't really pay you much attention. In fact, back then, I preferred Pat Boone and Bobby Darin and the like. Mac the Knife.
Oh, man, that's a good song.
Great song.
Yeah.
But I want you to know, I admire your staying power. You faded away, and you came back. It takes a great man to be able to do that.
Well, thank you, sir. And I can say the same for you.
Well, I don't quit. It's the Capricorn in me.
You're a Capricorn? Me too.
When's your birthday?
January 8th.
January 9th.
No. Well, this is like, well, it's like our karma to me, you know?
Well, whatever that means. You know, I do remember when the girls were younger, taking them to see one of your movies.
Mm-hmm.
You played two parts. You looked like yourself, and then sometimes you wore a blonde wig.
Oh, yeah, that was Kissing Cousins. Yeah, that was a real dramatic challenge for me, you know, to play two different roles.
Well, it looked very tricky.
Yeah.
Singing songs with yourself. You know, sometimes late at night, when nobody's listening, I like to sit down at the old 88 keys and play some tunes.
Oh, yeah? So do I.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, I'm not very good, but I play loud. You know, there was a song I used to sing to Pat, Mrs. Nixon. Well, it was before your time. You probably don't know it. My wild Irish rose.
The sweetest flower that grows.
You know it?
You may search everywhere,
but none can compare with my wild Irish rose. My wild Irish rose.
The sweetest flower that grows. You may search everywhere, but none can compare with my wild Irish rose.
Am I hearing what I think I'm hearing?
Yes, sir. I believe you are.
Yes, there were times.
Yes, there were times.
I'm sure you knew.
I'm sure you knew.
When I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all.
But through it all.
When there was doubt.
When there was doubt.
I ate it all.
And
spit it out. Have
faced it all.
And I stood tall.
And did it my way. Mistakes. I've made a few, but then again, too few to mention.
All right.
You know, Elvis, I'll bet it's fun to be you.
Well, you know, I'm just a singer, sir. But I mean, you're the most important man in the world. I mean, to sit here behind this desk and... Hey, do you think, Can I just sit in your chair, sir?
No, that wouldn't be a good idea. If Haldeman came in and saw that, he'd want to sit there, too. Now, Elvis, I'm running into another meeting, so let me just say this. My administration would welcome your help in fighting drugs, but we have no such thing as a federal agent at large.
Was all right, sir. You know, just, just being in the same room with you is so inspiring. I'm thinking maybe I should do more than just fight drugs. Or maybe I should just quit entertainment and go into politics. Or like Governor Reagan. And maybe become governor of Tennessee. And who knows, you know, one day, run for president myself. You know, with all my fans, I'll bet I could win.
Now, Elvis, I know we're both here for the same reason. We both love America. We are America. But Elvis, you've reached something few mortals on this planet will ever know. You transcend politics. You're loved by billions of people worldwide. But you risk that love in politics. You have to make the tough decisions, and that makes people angry. They start to hate you. They protest outside your window. Those bastards in the liberal media ridicule you on a daily basis. You want to be able to crush them like mosquitoes on a windshield. But fortunately, we have a Bill of Rights. So you do nothing. Now, after a lifetime of being loved by all your fans, do you really want to expose yourself to all of that?
What?
No, you don't. You can help your country and your president by remaining who you are, the king of rock and roll, an example of the good side of a drug-free America, and help by joining the president's war on drugs.
Well, sir, yeah, you know, I guess maybe you're right. But if I'm gonna truly help the country with this drug problem, I do need one thing from you.
Anything, name it.
I need to be named a real federal marshal for drug enforcement, sir, with a real badge now. Okay, not any of that honorary business.
Absolutely. In fact, I think it's a swell idea. When the children of America see that Elvis Presley is sanctioned to fight drugs, well, they'll think twice about turning off themselves.
Well, thank you very much, sir. Oh, I'm gonna do a lot of good work with this.
Well, just be sure you don't lose your credibility.
Sir, this is the proudest day of my life. You know, I just wish my mom was alive to see this. I mean, being here in the White House with the President of the United States appointing me a U.S. Marshal. Thank you, sir.
Let's take some photos.
What can you say? What really goes on inside the White House is absolutely terrifying.
Rosemary, would you send in Ollie?
Oh, sir, would you take a minute to also meet my bodyguards?
Oh, of course, of course. Rosemary, the bodyguards, too. Let's pose over here by the flag.
Oh, okay.
By the way, Elvis, did you ever mess around with Marilyn Monroe?
No, sir. Mm.
The Kennedys did, you know. Hoover played me the tapes.
Well, you know, I wish I had a tape recording of this meeting here. You know, it's like I'd play to my wife and to my little daughter.
Tape recording meetings. Ollie, I thought we'd pose here in front of the flags. You know, Elvis, I hope you don't mind my saying so, but you dress kind of strange, don't you?
Well, Mr. President, you got your show and I got mine.
Elvis got his badge, Nixon got his photo, and neither man made any use of either one. By 1972, Elvis's marriage had ended, and Nixon's plumber's unit had made its less-than-elegant entry into the Watergate Hotel. And thus began personal plummets for both men, from which neither fully recovered.
In the end, Richard Nixon had once again risen like a phoenix, to be hailed as an elder statesman. If you live long enough, you see everything.
I miss him. I wish he were still here. I wish he was still playing Las Vegas. Does that mean I'd have to rethink my act?
Whatever else you think of him, just ask yourself, how different would America and the 20th century have been had we been denied the presence of Richard Nixon and of Elvis Presley? Oh, and as befits the president and the king, that famous photograph of them together is the single most requested item at the Nixon Library at Yorba Linda. Hail, hail, rock and roll.
you be a ranger, that will do you no harm. I want you to bring the long and rocking shoe, cause tonight I'm gonna rock away all your blues. I heard the news.
There's good rocking tonight.
Good night, fellas.
See ya, y'all.
Good night, man.
Have
we enjoyed it.
Have you left the building yet, man? Yeah.